Madam DG, if you allow me, I have a long speech, but I may not necessarily lead it as it is. I'd prefer to express from the fond of my heart what I believe and what we are trying to achieve in Rwanda. Let me start by the critical issue of how do we address the access to capital for medium, small and medium enterprises. For many years in the past, we have been conducting survey to understand what are the key challenges SMEs are facing. And it came out all the time that access to capital was number one. And when you discuss with the financial institutions in the country why this challenge is permanent, and every year when you redo the survey, still access to finance appear to be the most constraining factor. We realize with a huge delay to understand why, but now we do understand actually the banking system we have in Africa, which was built on colonial economy, unfortunately so far, which has changed very little, is focusing on a segment of businesses which unfortunately are not yet the areas where most of the SMEs, particularly the startups one, are operating. And when you look at what are the requirements of commercial banks to support any borrower, most of the SMEs are out of reach. And when you measure the risks associated with lending money to small and medium enterprises, I have been the governor of Central Bank for 11 years. I was one of the tough governor to make sure commercial banks set very strong prudential framework to build their financial stability. And at the time of my period as a governor of the Central Bank, I took very little care about the SMEs. Now I am the Minister of Trade and the Industry, which has the primary responsibility to address the issues SMEs are faced. And I am a very interesting situation in my career when I engage the financial institutions to address the issues of SMEs. All these commercial bank managers are looking to me with a laugh and asking me, are you the previous governor of the Central Bank? And I can tell you it's very tough for me to have an answer. Because on one hand, I understand fully the way they are managing the risks. But on the other hand, I have to make sure I deliver on my assignment. So I have to engage with them on such a kind of ambiguous dialogue. Because now I'm convinced that building an ecosystem to support SMEs, we need to think about how we diversify our financial ecosystem to make sure we have a strong institution geared to support the small and medium enterprises, and how we set up institutions which significantly remove part of the risks that commercial banks are not ready to bear in the current circumstances. This, in my view, has been the missing link in African countries to support the small and medium enterprises, particularly the startups one. I came to realize that in terms of how within our institutions in Africa, even in other emerging economies, How do we identify people who have innovative ideas, who can actually or are ready to create new SMEs, but they don't have money? They don't have money. I have been going around in Rwanda and realized that no one was caring about such kind of people. And you can't imagine the lack of such a kind of institutional framework to address such kind of issues may be itself constraining the growth potential of a country, because only the young innovators who have new ideas to establish businesses can really fuel the growth prospects of a country out of the traditional arrangement. So that's the reason why when you come to Rwanda now, among what we are trying to build, we are setting up institutions which are there on a daily basis to receive anyone who believes has a business idea. But once you receive such person, you should make sure yourself you have the capacity to be useful for him. Because these people are looking for a multifaceted of kind of support. First of all, I tell you, among those, a big number of them are not entrepreneurs at all. They have in mind that doing business just to get money, which is not correct. So the first thing you have to do is to test our ability to become real entrepreneurs. And I am sure there is a good number of them, but not all of them, who have the potential to become real entrepreneurs. So the first thing really we need to establish in a country is to make sure you have institutions which can incubate such a kind of potential entrepreneurs to measure their capacity to do business. But for this to happen, you need to have resources which are out of commercial banks lending. You need really to have resources from the government budget to do this. But also such a kind of assistance has to be decentralized as much as you can, because such a kind of entrepreneurs are all over the country. In Rwanda, what we have done now, we have established within any local government a unity in charge of business development and employment orientation. The purpose of this unity is really to identify these people and connect them to other institutions we are establishing. The second institution, which is, I think, the most critical one, is a business development fund, which has created branches in every district with the primary purpose to deliver only three things. The first one, different channel, a young entrepreneur come to them to share with them their business idea. The first thing to do, because this business development fund is a financial institution, they have to understand the financial feasibility of the proposal of this entrepreneur. But once you are convinced as a business development fund that the proposal makes sense, what do you do to help him to deliver on what he has in mind? So among the products business development fund is going to deliver, because sometime these startups may be in a position to go to a commercial bank, try to convince a bank to give them the money. If they succeed to get support from a commercial bank, and the problem is guarantee, collateral, the business development fund may provide for startups guarantee cover up to 75% of what commercial banks are ready to risk in lending to such kind of institutions. But we've got a such a kind of situation where even the 25% risk, residual risk, commercial banks are not ready to take it. For key innovative project, the business fund has the responsibility to take equity, in the startups. So the business development fund is creating a kind of venture capital built in within this, its operation, to make sure key innovative startups don't die because no one is ready to take up any residual risk in their business. This, in my view, is contributing significantly to rescue a number of good proposals which can now undertake the journey to go to the market. The Business Development Fund, apart from the guarantee scheme and the venture capital fund to support key innovative startups, because convinced that commercial banks have very small appetite to lend to startups. In Rwanda, we have established a network of saving and credit cooperatives which are spread all over the country, and which, to tell you how these institutions are making a difference in Rwanda in terms of financial inclusion, in the last 5 years, financial inclusion in Rwanda has been growing dramatically from a low level of 20% 5 years ago. Now we are above 40%, simply due to this Umurenge Sako, like we call them in Rwanda. And it's very interesting to see how these proximity institutions are more sensitive to support businesses, more businesses in rural areas. And actually, I was surprised because they have more appetite to take risk. And very interestingly, the risk of failure within the portfolio is very low, because these are really proximity institutions. They give you money, but on a daily basis, they watch you to see what you do with the money. Unfortunately, their capacity to lend to small and medium enterprise in a massive scale is extremely limited, because their resources are mainly small deposit by rural people. Now, to address this constraint, Business Development Fund has the mandate to work with whoever in Rwanda, being the government, the NGOs, development partners, who are ready to fundraise longer-term resources to be on rent to the SACCO to refinance small and medium loans to the businesses. So this is contributing once again to support an increasing number of small businesses in rural areas. So this is what we are trying to do to address the needs of startups. But SMEs, you know, there are startups, but we have also SMEs which are there, which are struggling to survive and grow. These as well need to continue to be supported. And once again, their dialogue with commercial banks to get financial resources to continue their journey to the global market, is the dialogue is not very conducive. They still need to continue getting support from government institutions. In our institutional ecosystem, to make sure we don't lose our obligation to continue supporting this institution, we met in a country, we have making a kind of mapping exercise to know the SMEs we talk about in Rwanda, in what sectors they are, in what districts they are. We come up with 20 SME clusters. Now, for these clusters, we are developing an SME cluster development strategy. That's where the International Trade Center has really been extremely useful. They are joining us in this journey to make this SME cluster something which is live, which can establish a framework for public-private dialogue to support the growth of small and medium enterprises. And one of the critical initiatives we set up is what you call SME Forum, where on a quarterly basis, a number of SME cluster met to discuss about their challenges. All government institutions, NGOs, development partners who have a will to support this institution attend. And from such a kind of forum, came up a kind of action plan where different stakeholders come together to put efforts together to support this institution. But from the government perspective, because we need, there is really a very strong need to continue supporting this institution, there are a number of government institutions which are very critical in the process of supporting this institution. The first one, because all these institutions, these SMEs, when they come, they reach a stage where they want to scale up their business, they need to certify their product, even their system. That's the reason why the Rwanda Bureau of Standards, in its core mandate, is now focusing on small and medium enterprises to make sure they meet the quality standards, to make sure for those who have the potential even to go out there in the region and to the global market to distribute their products, they are not constrained by these limitations. And I can tell you the scope of assignment for the government in this area is huge. And I think there is really a very strong need to make sure that we have significant resources to support SMEs, because some of the time they don't have the capacity to cover the cost of these services from themselves. The second institution is we are setting up to complement what the Bureau of Standards is doing. We have established a national industrial development research authority. This industrial research authority has the core responsibility to make sure that small and medium industries in Rwanda have the support to access to appropriate technology wherever they are. Or they can even invest in their own research to support emerging SMEs, which particularly those who are adding value to local raw materials and can be supported in research to make sure they produce a prototype of products which can be distributed in the country and elsewhere. So these institutions are providing supplement services to make sure SMEs in Rwanda are getting support needed as they grow. But this is not enough. In Rwanda, we have many initiatives. For example, access to market. This is fundamental. I am going to spend 5 minutes to conclude my presentation. Access to market is key. And don't expect an SME to access outside market when you even don't facilitate it to access your own market. And we have really to deep dig and understand why, when you go through the public procurement system in a number of countries, local SMEs are excluded. Not because there is a deliberate policy to exclude them, but simply because we have been distracted by practice which don't have any economic sense. To give you an example of what I'm saying, for example, a Minister of Education, which manages a huge budget, and among the goods they procure, you can find, for example, chalks, you know, chalks we use this in the classrooms. But you will be surprised that in a country you have an SME which is manufacturing trucks, but can't access the huge market of the Minister of Education. Why? Simply because the Minister of Education, when they go out there to make a tender, they mix chocks, books, uniforms in one lot. And you understand, there is no small industry which can compete to get such a tender, apart from traders who run to Dubai, China, to combine such a kind of product and bid. For a long period of time, SMEs in Africa have been excluded from such kind of opportunity simply due to very funny procurement practice. I think these are the areas we really need to look to understand how our procurement policies and practice should be designed to support the growth of our small and medium industries. In Rwanda currently, I succeed to pass a cabinet paper, but it was very interesting during the cabinet where we were discussing these issues. No one could understand why we have been doing differently. This is just an example. The second example, when we talk about supporting SMEs to reach the global value chain, we have a number of SMEs who have been getting contracts from Uganda, from DRC, to supply a number of goods. But for an SME to be able to implement, let's say, a $2 million contract in 12 months to deliver something, they absolutely need funding from a financial institution to prepare the necessary production to respond to such a kind of a contract. No financial institution in Rwanda will give a loan to an SME if the SME is not able to provide an acceptable collateral in the kind of big building which have the same value of money. And we have a number of cases where SMEs have been losing such a kind of opportunity simply because they don't have such a kind of a collateral to be able to respond to these needs. So what we are trying to do, and I am sure in other countries they are doing the same, we have established what you call an export growth fund, which mainly is targeting small and medium enterprises who are looking to join the global market through different value chains. The export growth fund has three components. The first one is what you call a catalyst investment fund. The catalyst investment fund is simply to facilitate SMEs accessing longer term investment at a reasonable interest rate. Because our commercial bank, even those who can provide some lending, the interest rate is above 18%. Lending at 18% and you go out there compete with someone else who go to credit from banks at 4 or 5%, you understand you are already in a very unfavorable condition. So the catalyst investment fund will subsidy the interest rates between the prime commercial bank rates and a benchmark rate we assume should be the normal rate exporters in Rwanda should be getting support to be able to compete out there. The second component of the Export Growth Fund is an export guarantee scheme. The export guarantee scheme simply is to provide a 270 days guarantee to an SME who got a contract, who is looking to export in the regional markets or to the global markets, but need short-term working capital to achieve or to deliver on a contract. So this is a very wonderful new initiative, and we are working with the International Trade Center to implement this export grant scheme in a very professional manner, learning from other countries like India. The Exim Bank of India have started with such kind of initiative. and Exim Bank of India is working with us to make sure that we operationalize this guarantee scheme in a very professional manner to get results. The third component of the Export Growth Fund is what we call a matching grant. You know, exporting is very costly. And when companies have a comfortable domestic market which may make them survive, there are very few who are looking to go out there and pay the cost of entering an external market. So what you are looking to do really is to see how the government may encourage people to go out there to enter the external market, but sharing the cost. So the matching grant scheme is a matching grant where the government cover 50% of the expenses for an SME looking to go out there and enter the external markets. So this Export Growth Fund, in my view, is going to be very instrumental in facilitating SMEs accessing the market, particularly those which are looking to go out. So these are some of the few initiatives in Rwanda we are trying to develop to build what I initially called these necessary institutional ecosystem to support the emergence and the growth and even the transformation of these SMEs into global participants or participant to the global value chains. So, Madam Gonzalez, once again, I want to thank you for the opportunity to speak to this audience. I hope this Rwandan experience may inspire some of our colleagues, but we also need to learn more about the experiences in the other countries going forward, because we need to emulate best practice when we deliberate to introduce such kind of initiatives in a least developed country like Rwanda. I thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you, Your Excellency. And I have to say, it's very rare that you get to hear such refreshingly open sort of feedback from someone in government. It's amazing just to see the journey that they've come on. And if you've done business with Rwanda, you'll see that's actually not unique. Every government official you do business with in Rwanda has got performance metrics. They sort of, you know, you walk into a meeting, everyone's got agendas, they want to learn, they want to share. It's one of the best places that we do business in, and I'm hoping that we can sort of spread that across the region. So, yes, we're going to change speakers now, so I just like you to all please join me in thanking our illustrious speakers. So now we're going to call up two new speakers. So we've heard about sort of the overall environment and also the sort of the way that government can enable. Now we're going to hear a little bit about, you know, what is the data telling us about what's happening? And also, you know, take an example from another part of the world that may be helpful for us in this context. So in order to help us through that, we've got two great speakers here. We've got Marion Jansen, from the ITC. She's the chief economist, and she's going to walk us through some data, and then I'll introduce the next speaker after that.
Thank you very much. I will follow up from the discussion, from the introduction that was already given by Arantxa, and I'll present you a bit more about this flagship publication that we published in October this year, and that is called SME Competitiveness Outlook. It has a year after the title, 2015, and that means that we intend to publish this again in forthcoming years, the next one in 2016. The title already tells you that it's going to focus on SMEs and their competitiveness. Okay. It's not on, maybe. What you will find in this publication, here you see the front cover, some copies were in the room, is a description of the theme SME competitiveness that we hope is comprehensive, but also accessible to a non-specialist audience, accessible to both policymakers and the private sector. We have done most of the work in-house at ITC, but we know we're not the only people working on this theme, so we have invited a number of global thought leaders to contribute to our report. You will find their stories in the report. You will find a lot of information about the practical work ITC is doing on SME competitiveness in countries, and very interestingly, I hope you find interesting, you will find 25 country profiles on SME competitiveness in this flagship. I'm not sure whether we can switch now, but let me go on then without slides. The theme of the report this year is on SMEs and their role for inclusive growth. There are 100 pages on this topic in the report. I will show you with one slide what we make as a main argument here. SMEs are less productive than large firms. SMEs pay lower wages than large firms. That's the case everywhere. That's the case in my country, Germany. That's the case in Switzerland, where I live. That's the case in Kenya. That's the case in Rwanda. But the gap between the productivity of SMEs and large firms, the gap between wages in SMEs and large firms, is much bigger in developing countries than in industrialized countries. The gap is twice or three times as big in developing countries. So if you manage to address that productivity gap, that competitiveness gap, you trigger growth automatically because 90% of your firms are going to be more productive. If you manage to address that competitiveness gap, you trigger inclusiveness because those over 90% of your firms, they pay the lowest wages and they employ the poorest people in your country. You get inclusive growth through a pure business argument if you focus on SMEs, as Rwanda has been doing in the last years. I will skip this slide. You will find the overview of the business literature on SMEs. And one of the pillars of the report is this SME competitiveness grid that Arantxa already told you about. We analyze in the report, in the 25 country profiles you find in the report, SME competitiveness according to this grid. You will find whether in the countries we look at how countries perform in the ability of firms to connect. And we define connectivity above all by connectivity to market-relevant information, because we think in fast-moving global markets, information is key. Whether with that and access to information they are able to compete at any given moment in time, but also whether they are able to change if markets are demanding this from them, if they are able to make the investments and the changes in their strategy that are necessary. That are the three pillars of competitiveness. You will also find in the report where weaknesses or strengths may lie in your country. Is it whether at the entrepreneurial level? Is it the firms themselves that seem not to be doing the right thing? Is it in the ecosystem around the firms, the immediate business environment, the clusters, do they exist or not? Or is it at the highest macro level in the national environment? I'll give you only a few examples. Here you get the overall SME competitiveness grid of sub-Saharan Africa. So we grouped the countries we have in our sample from Africa together, and we look at where are weaknesses and strengths for SMEs in sub-Saharan Africa. And what you see is a lot of white, which means neither strength nor weakness, but you see a red in one place. It's the connectivity of small enterprises. And what we highlight in the report is that, yes, the finance gap that is being discussed a lot in the policy debate is an important one, but we do say do not forget the digital gap. It's important in LDCs, in Africa, and it matters for SMEs. Next slide, please. You will find for 25 countries more detailed information, and here I only show some of the countries and some of the pieces of information you will find. You will find 11 African countries, sub-Saharan African countries in the report, out of 25, so that's quite a lot. And while we did not create an index that gives you one number that comparing countries, we do give you the kind of information that will allow you to look in detail at what are strengths or weaknesses in particular countries. Here I put up Kenya, because we are in Kenya, Rwanda, because we had a speaker from Rwanda. I compare with Colombia, a country of a similar size as Kenya in terms of population, but with a significantly higher GDP, and Indonesia, much larger country, but a country that may be competing for certain markets with a number of African countries. Here we look at firm-level competitiveness. What is happening at the firm level? Not national environment, not ecosystems. And what you find that in countries like Kenya and in countries like Rwanda, the area of finance has been supported for quite a bit in the last years, as we just heard. And we see that large firms, that's the outer ring, medium-sized firms, and to a lesser extent, small-sized firms are getting more access to finance, in particular in Kenya. In Rwanda, we see that smaller firms, that's typically the inner cycle, do still not manage to access finance well. Here we see bank finance. Here these are also financial indicators. But what we see that in both countries, where they perform badly is in the use of email and websites. Email websites in small firms and medium-sized firms, widely underrepresented with respect to large firms. And look at Colombia, and we find this a lot in Latin America, wide use of e-connectivity, spread not just among large firms, medium-sized firms, but also among small firms. Surprise for us, in a number of Asian countries, including here Indonesia, e-connectivity very, very bad. In some countries, Indonesia also financial access bad. Thailand, on the other hand, financial access is working very well for SMEs. So no simple stories there when you look at the 25 country profiles, but a lot of material to get very national, local flavors and get deep insights on what is functioning and what is not functioning at the national level, at the firm level, on the ecosystems, in different areas of competitiveness. And we hope that this will be very useful for policymakers to continue to provide guidance to their firms, and for those who want to provide assistance to them. Here, I will not delve on this. The kind of initiatives we are undertaking in this area to help small and medium-sized enterprises, to help policymakers. And if you want to have a look at one of these, our e-learning platform is a very active one, directly helping small and medium-sized enterprises, and you will find a booth of the SME business e-learning platform downstairs, close to the reception. So please go and have a look there and learn more about our activities. And last but not least, if you did not manage to get a copy of this report, here you will find it online. Please have a look. And if you have ideas on how we should move forward with this, what we can do for your countries, for your firms to assist, please get in touch with us.
Thank you, Marianne. And what I loved about that was you didn't just give the data, you gave the insight, which I think is what the invaluable piece is. So thank you. So next we're going to have a speaker from Latin America. His name is Francisco Estrazulas, and he's going to talk to us about a project that he's worked on called Connect Americas, which takes a lot of the theory that we've been talking about and actually puts it into action. So please join me in welcoming Francisco.
Thank you very much. I'm going to stand over there so I can pass my own slides, so thanks. Thank you for the invitation. I'm here to share with you the journey that has been Connect Americas. This is an initiative of the Inter-American Development Bank. Within the IDB, this is led by the Trade and Investment Unit, where the unit of the IDB that provides loans to countries on matters related to trade facilitation, trade promotion. We also give technical assistance to countries in the negotiation and implementation of free trade agreements. So I'm here to talk to you about Connect Americas. It's quite an innovative idea in our region. Connect Americas is a social media network for small and medium-sized businesses to help them internationalize. It's the kind of a LinkedIn for small and medium-sized companies. I'll tell you a little bit about how the idea came about. In our division, aside from giving loans to countries on these matters, we've been organizing for the past 9 years business matchmaking events that are sector specific. We have one called LAC Flavors that is focused on food and beverages. We have one called Outsource to LAC that is focused on international trade of services. Now, we had observed from these events that for each dollar that the IDB spends subsidizing the participation of Latin American exporters and bringing buyers from all over the world, we were generating about $70 of business. So in a way, we were demonstrating that there was a Latin American supply and a global demand that existed out there, but that wasn't meeting on its own. It was meeting in these spaces that we were putting together and in similar spaces that chambers of commerce or trade promotion organizations were putting together. So then we thought, okay, how many opportunities are being missed because people don't have the time or the resources to attend the events? And what can we do about it? And there came the idea of setting up an online platform that would, in a way, reproduce what was taking place in this event, but in an online setting. Why did we do this? And I'm going to start sharing with you kind of the justification or some statistics about Latin American company behavior that kind of justifies the type of solution that we came up with. Now you have to close this. Okay. There we go. So we see in Latin America and the Caribbean, 47% of our population are connected to the internet. That's about 280 million people. This is an indicator that compares well with other regions in the world, such as Middle East and North Africa and the East Asia Pacific region. Not only are we connected to the internet, but we are very social in the internet. 95% of Latin Americans that have access to the internet use social media. They use Twitter, they use Facebook, they use LinkedIn. This is, compared to the United States, a pretty high figure, where 74% of US citizens or that have access to the internet use social media. If we see here, out of the 10 countries in the world that are most active on social media, 5 of those countries are Latin American countries. So we like to be social on the internet, and these are the skills of using social media are spreading out throughout the region. So we thought, let's tap into those skills that are becoming more broadly available into a setting that would help SMEs internationalize. Well, not only are we being social, we're also doing business online. And here the statistics are very strong. In 2003 in Latin America, we traded $1.6 billion online. Between 2003 and 2013, that increased 44 times to $70 billion traded online by companies in Latin America and the Caribbean. And it's expected that it will triple between 2013 and 2017 to $220 billion. So we are doing business online. Now, there's opportunities for the SMEs. When we compare Latin American SMEs with other regions in the world and certain countries, Latin American SMEs contribute with around 13% of total exports in a region. In countries like Thailand and Malaysia, that's over 40%. In Europe is around, and the United States, and East Asia is around 30, 33, 35% of total exports. So we still have room to grow in order to match comparable economies. Now, what happens with Latin American SME exports? They're very concentrated. Generally, the SME exports one product to one market. When we compare this with countries like Norway, where SMEs export 7 products to 10 countries on average, right? So there's a lot to do to help SMEs diversify also the products and the markets that they are doing business with. Now, why is this important? Why is IDB investing so much in this? Because SMEs that internationalize perform much better in some critical indicators that have important effects or impact on our economies. They pay higher wages, they have more sales, they're more productive, their employment grows much faster than companies that haven't internationalized. So we think that helping them internationalize can have a strong impact in our economy. Now, what is holding back the Latin American SMEs from internationalizing? 3 very clear barriers that we have identified through focus groups and meetings and research that we've done throughout our region. First, access to trustworthy clients abroad. This is very clear. You see it in large, in small countries. We heard a bunch of horror stories of international trade as we were doing these focus groups. So trustworthy clients is a key barrier that we thought we could help overcome with a solution such as Connect Americas. The second very clear barrier, also present everywhere, is access to information. And there we found a range of issues, going from very basic knowledge of how to export, what government agency do I need to go to, what stamps I need to get, to what are the requirements to enter my product into the market that I want to enter, to more, if you will, subtle information of, okay, what's the latest trend in the demand of my product in the country that I want to enter, be in terms of certifications, packaging, color, size. You know, those types of, that type of information was preventing companies from selling their products to more markets. And finally, a very widespread barrier related to what the minister was talking about, access to finance. And we have the same problem that he mentioned. Banks require collateral. A lot of SMEs don't have the collateral that banks require. This affects even more the services exporter, where the main asset is their intellectual property that banks a lot of times don't consider as collateral. So what did we do? here's Connect Americas. This is the landing page that the unregistered user accesses. As you see on the top left side, the site is structured in three service areas that we call Connect, Learn, and Finance. Connect aimed at the access to trustworthy clients barrier, Learn aimed at the information barrier, and Finance aimed at the financing barrier that I just mentioned. Now, here are some print screens of the user dashboard, meaning what the user that has registered on the site sees. If you see on the left side of the screen, every time you log into Connect Americas, the system recommends a certain number of companies that may be relevant to you based on who you are. So for example, if I register, I said I'm a Colombian, I'm an exporter of fresh fruit, I'm interested in entering the US and the European market, in that section of the platform I'm gonna find Europeans that are importing fresh fruit from Colombia, or companies in Colombia that can sell to me goods and services related to the international trade of fresh fruit, packaging certifications, et cetera. And then I click on a company profile, I learn more about the company, and then there's the individuals that work in that company that are logged into Connect Americas and can send a message to them in the same way that you can send internal messages on LinkedIn. Then we have communities. These are sector-specific business communities. So we have one, for example, on food and beverages, where companies upload what they're looking to buy, what they're looking to sell. They start interacting with each other. It's a good way of seeing, you know, what's out there in terms of supply and demand. And then we also promote events organized by IDB, by chambers of commerce, by organizations. Events are helpful for companies in their internationalization. Then we have the Learn service area. One of the most successful components of our platform has been the courses that we offer in the Connect Americas Academy. These are massive online open courses. In this first year and a half of the platform, we've had 13,000 people register for the 9 courses that we have. Out of those 13,000, 33% have completed the courses, which is a pretty high completion rate in the sector. We also have videos there. We're betting very strongly on collecting peer-to-peer interaction, right? Learning about the experiences of the entrepreneurs and the business people themselves. What barriers did you face when you tried to internationalize your company? How did you overcome? We think that that's very valuable knowledge for a business person trying to learn from a peer. Then we have, well, Nipime Plus, it's a self-assessment tool. We have some trade intelligence tools where you can see amounts and volumes exported of each product to each country, what tariffs apply, et cetera, some practical information for the SMEs. Then we have articles that we write. And then there's the business support services, and there I'm gonna talk just a little bit about that. One of the pillars of the marketing of this platform has been through our network of local partners. These are chambers of commerce, trade promotion organizations, government agencies that work on SMEs and on internationalization matters. And the basic value proposition that we give these organizations is, look, you can use Connect Americas to promote what you do, the services that you offer, the events you're organizing, the contents that you want to disseminate, et cetera. And in exchange, we ask that you invite your member companies to join this free platform, because it's free for the companies and the organizations. And this is the section where we are promoting the contents and the services from these local partners that we have in this initiative. So this is the Learn part. In finance, I'll tell you very quickly. On the left side, you see there financing options. There, what we have is we offer commercial banks in each of the countries in Latin America the possibility of promoting their financial products and services on the platform. Products and services that are focused on SMEs and on international trade. Now, what's the catch? That in order for these banks to be able to promote their products on the platform, they have to commit to assessing the risk of the companies using a single application form. So let's say you're an entrepreneur in Ecuador. In Ecuador, we have 10 banks that are promoting their products and services on the platform. Well, I fill out one form and I send it to the 10 banks. And those 10 banks have committed to making me an offer based on the information that I provided. So it's very important to be clear that this is not improving the terms or the conditions of access to finance, but it's really reducing the cost and the level of effort of finding out what's available for a company such as mine in my country. Then we have a section where we promote the IDB group projects, going from loans or equity investments that we do to technical assistance or co-financing that we do for certifications or trade missions, the kind of support that the IDB gives to SMEs on internationalization matters. And then we have a link to another platform that the IDB has created called Invest Americas that is designed to link investors with investment opportunities in the region. So it's basically a space where the entrepreneur makes an online pitch to an eventual investor. So that's the basic structure of the platform. This has been done with four anchor partners, very important organizations. We have Google that has partnered with us, helping us with the algorithms that make the recommendations based on who I am. That's why that dashboard that the user sees depends on who I am. We have DHL that has provided a lot of information, webinars, technical notes on how to export to certain countries, and they also provide discounts to Connect America's users that hire DHL services. We have Visa that has been working with us in promoting this platform through what they call Visa Empresarial, which is a platform they have for SMEs, and they're also helping us think about how we can turn this platform into a transactional platform where you can actually make a payment through a platform, because today is just for connections. And finally, we have Alibaba.com, the great Chinese e-market site that helps us by giving verifications to companies at a discounted rate, and they're helping us with a strategy to enter the Chinese market. So far, it's been a year and a half. We've had 600,000 visitors, 48,000 registered business people on the platform from about 90 countries. So they go way beyond Latin America and the Caribbean. And we have, through surveys to our users, found out that in this year and a half, there's been $11.3 million in deals between the companies that are registered in the platform and $2.3 billion in generated leads, intentions, that our users have reported through these surveys. Here are some examples. This is Heneca. She's from Jamaica. She exports pepper hot sauce to Colombia, and she found her client through Connect America. This is Carlos. He has a contact center in Honduras, and he found a U.S. client that he gives contact center services from Honduras. And this is Martin Turcati from Uruguay. He has an engineering company. He found a Brazilian client through the platform. Now, what did we do in 2015? A couple of the innovations that we have within Connect America that I wanted to share with you. The first one is virtual matchmaking, which is a software for business-to-business matchmaking events, the same software we use for the events that I mentioned at the beginning of the presentation. But so what happens is you register, you list your product that you're looking to buy or sell. The system recommends companies that may be of interest. You accept, reject, and request meetings through the system, and then the day before the event, you get an agenda where you know from 9 to 9:20, you have a video conference with this person, from 9:20 to 9:40, and with this other client in another country. So it's a very cheap and efficient way of putting together events where you bring buyers and sellers from all over the world, and the business people can participate from their own offices without the need to travel abroad. And then finally, we have developed a new content type in the platform that is business opportunities. These are very specific purchasing announcements coming from the 26 governments that are members of the IDB in Latin America and the Caribbean, and from large companies that have joined a program that we call Made in the Americas. So for example, McDonald's, Walmart, Cisco Systems, Grupo Bimbo, these are all companies that are publishing procurement announcements in Connect Americas, and the system is recommending these business opportunities to each of our users depending on where they are and what their companies do. So that's what we're doing. Sorry if I took too long, but I wanted to share it with you and help you reflect about how it can work in Africa.
Thank you so much, Francisco. That was fascinating, and I'm sure I could see sort of heads kind of nodding as people are starting to think about the implications of creating something like that in Africa. So thank you both to Marion and Francisco again. So we're going to do a little switch up now and move to more of a panel and conversation format. I think we've had lots of ideas being thrown around. And so I'd like to welcome our panelists up on up to the sort of podium, please, if that's okay. So if we could have Dr. Asfour, please. Be great. And Seth Tuam Akobo, please, from Ghana. And also Kanini Mutoni. And Andrew Mutuma, please, if you could please join me. And we'll start with a little bit of a conversation amongst ourselves, but then we are going to open it up for Q&A. So I've been reliably informed that the panelists are very much up for challenging questions. So please think of some really fun ones. So I guess we've been hearing lots of themes. And what I really liked about this panel is it's very diverse. We have people from not just sort of, you know, very African focused, but actually we've got people from East and West Africa. We've got, you know, people from private sector, public sector. And so I think you'll get a good variety of opinions on this. So I'll start by maybe just sort of asking each of you to briefly introduce yourselves, but also, like, what's the one takeaway that you've taken away from the proceedings so far around SMEs and competitiveness, and you know, and then we can maybe move on from there. So, Andrew, would you like to start?
Okay, my name is Andrew Mutuma, CEO of DHL Express Kenya. I think for me the main takeaway from that is the financing aspect of SMEs. And we find that a great challenge when it comes to working with SMEs in the country, particularly when we are offering services and in terms of just getting payment for the services that we offer.
Yeah, hello everybody. My name is Kanini Mutoni. I'm the Director of Investment for the East Africa Trade and Investment Hub. We are a trade and investment support institution based here in Nairobi, and we cover five countries in the region, including Madagascar, Seychelles. In terms of my main takeaway, I think for me, it's beyond financing. That's what, you know, picking up from Honorable Kanimba's speech is that SMEs can get lots of money, and I think we have a lot of evidence that there are a lot of development dollars and private capital dollars in the market. But I think ultimately, if SMEs cannot access international markets, there is a very big problem. And this is one of the things that the East Africa Trade and Investment Hub is actually doing. We're linking SMEs directly to buyers and institutions in international markets, specifically the US, to actually enable them to achieve internationalization.
Thank you very much. My name is Seth Trumakobua. I'm the Chief Executive of Association of Ghana Industries, one of the main industrial associations, and our main function is to promote SME development and industries in general. And we dwell very much on policy advocacy because we think it's critical for development. One of the key issues that I take from here is the fact that SME development is actually all-encompassing. There is firm-level development that is required. The SME level themselves, the SMEs themselves need to know a lot. They need to develop their capacity to be able to do international business. But then there is also the policy angle. Government has a role to play. Major other institutions also have a very specific role to play. And you need to have all these things working for SME development. I think that is very critical. Thank you.
Good afternoon. I am Dr. Asfour. I am the chair for the Comesa Business Council. The Comesa Business Council is the voice of the private sector in the whole over 19 countries of Eastern and Southern Africa, with more than 500 million people, half of the African continent. And the Comesa Business Council is really the voice of the private sector. And we have a working group actually for SMEs. And I think the takeaway here is not, it's a holistic approach. It's the whole ecosystem of how we really have SMEs competitive with reference to building the capacity of SMEs themselves or the lobbying and advocacy for the legislation and the laws that empower SMEs. And reference, the third pillar is about how we make the SMEs product competitive and standard and accessible to the market. So it's really the whole ecosystem, and that's what actually we're doing Comesa Business Council. And I think within our presentation we'll be highlighting more about what role can the partners of development do with reference to the governments, the civil society, the private sector.
Perfect. And actually, staying with you, Dr. Asfour, for a second, would you mind talking about like one or two key initiatives that you are driving through the Comesa Business Council that's having impact?
Well, actually, as I mentioned, actually, the whole ecosystem is, I call it the triad of empowerment, three pillars. The first pillar is the people, investing in the people themselves who are the real entrepreneurs. The SMEs are driven by the entrepreneurs. So we are doing programs for building the capacity of the entrepreneurs themselves and how to really educate them, build their capacity to be able to address the market, to educate them how to deal with banks, to deal with actually the whole ecosystem. The second pillar is the policy and the advocacy. What we do, and this is a very impressive about the Comesa Treaty, that as a private sector, we integrate with the policy organs, with the heads of the states. So what policy in place is there to empower the SMEs? In every Comesa summit, with all the heads of states and governments are there, we as the Comesa Business Council, we have our Comesa Business Forum. We addressed the heads of states last year in our Comesa Business Forum. I addressed the heads of states. I asked for, because we did an SME working group, what are the needs of them? They need a special preferential treatment for them. And we were very lucky that Kenya now has implemented this. 30% of all government procurement goes to SMEs, women, youth, and disabled. So this is how we integrate actually and advocate for what the SMEs need. Like the Minister of Rwanda has been saying now, they need allocated fund for this. We also address the heads of state telling them they need this funds for actually starting their business for export promotion. And actually the third pillar is the product. What product in place? If we empower them as an entrepreneurs with the personal empowerment programs and we advocate for policy, what product they have which is competitive? So the value addition of competitiveness, of standards, what we do. One project we have with the Commercial Business Council is what we call sourcing from local partners. So we made an agreement with several corporates in the region, including hotels, to source from the local partners, SMEs. So we build their capacity. We train the SMEs on how to meet the standards and the quality of those corporates. And we have trained only this year 58 SMEs within the region to supply to big hotels like Broche, like Sarova, like Serena. And this is a three-year program that we are doing to empower our people on the ground, the small and medium enterprises. So this is actually part of what the Comesa is doing, plus the advocacy campaign. Also what we do is like business-to-business linkages, and we have heard from Inter-American Bank. We do all the time business-to-business linkages. We link the SMEs from different parts to have export and import across our 19 countries. We have a platform, actually, and through our business membership, we supply all the information. We do the clustering, actually, which is very important. Clustering in groups in which sectors, whether agriculture, agribusiness, textile and garments, we have construction, we have financial services. So in each cluster, we have all the database of our SMEs across the 19 countries, and we link them together. We do trade fairs within our Comesa events. More than that also, there is another thing which is we go for, which is about facilitating the trade, because for us as Comesa, we're 19 countries, we are promoting to have a one visa for the Comesa, which make very important how we have free movement of persons and business. And we have also, with reference to the e-marketing and e-commerce, we have a lot of training for the Comesa trade facilitation, because we have a Comesa agreement that there is they are exempted from customs, the product. So this is also how we empower our SMEs to know about information about our trade agreements and how they access the regional market. This is part I can follow on other projects after that.
Wonderful, thank you, that's a lot. So I think, you know, one of the things that's very important for SMEs, obviously, is access to the network, to financing, and to those opportunities. But something that struck me yesterday, I was sort of at an ITC conference, and today, is this idea of SMEs often don't have access to the information when they're trading cross-border of, you know, what are the import export duties, what free trade agreements do they have access to, how do they actually do business. And I was struck by the fact that DHL was a partner on Connect Americas on precisely this topic. Can you maybe elaborate a little bit on, you know, what you're doing to try and help SMEs with that information?
Thank you. I think for DHL Sub-Saharan Africa, there are a couple of things that we are doing. And just from Sub-Saharan region is that we have a program called Going Beyond Borders. Now, what we do is spend time with SMEs talking about processes and procedures for import and export. And these are normally just free workshops where we spend time with SMEs that we've worked with before, and even some that we have not worked with before. And if there is anything they require to understand as far as how business is done, we're able to let them know this is what happens. But going back to what we are also doing in Kenya, is giving some of the SMEs that we have here, because 92% of those we work with in our customer base are purely SMEs. So what we will tend to do is they will send us an email and say, I would like to import something from, say, the US, or I'd like to export it to Brazil. What do I need to do? And we will then be able to get back to them. Now, I know one of the things that we looked at is in terms of the penetration of internet users in Kenya. But, funny enough, for Kenya, it's almost at 29 million users as of statistics as at the end of August 2015. So fantastic penetration here. And to go a step further, we now have over 95% of our customers now registered under our software tools. Now, what that does is two things. If I want to send something out of Kenya or bring it in, we allow you visibility. So you don't have to keep calling us all the time for you to find out where your goods are, where your letters are. You will just be able to do that on your phone or on your laptop. But the other thing that we are able to give you as a result of that is better control when you're working with your suppliers or when you're working with your customers, because you're able to go back to them and say, this is the position, we're working on it, and we'll get back to you. So ideally, we've tried to do that. But one other thing we have also gone ahead to do is we understand the challenges of SMEs in as far as finances are concerned. So if a customer, for instance, wants to send something to somebody internationally, we actually allow the international partner to pay for it rather than the SME paying for it here. So we can actually have the international partner open an account in another country and they can pay for the service. What that does as a result of SMEs not having the sort of capital we require is make it easier for them in terms of ensuring that they export and they import. Thank you.
So I'm just going to give you back the mic, Kanini. So from your perspective, sort of we've sort of seen, I guess, one aspect of it, which is kind of bringing the community together, the other aspect, which is helping inform and enable the actual sort of transaction itself. A lot of U.S. investment is coming into Africa. And I know, speaking to sort of U.S. investors, that they complain about they don't know how to find that match, that they've got the money, they don't know how to find the match. And then you hear from sort of people on the ground here that they've got opportunities and they haven't found the match. How do you match people with the hub?
Yeah, I mean, Shanetsa, great question. If you let me, I just wanted to comment a little bit on the professor's comment around the 30% procurement that is now open to SMEs. I think that's a fantastic initiative from the perspective of the government, but I just also wanted to highlight that we're talking to a lot of SMEs who've had access to these opportunities for procurement. They have supplied goods, and they haven't been paid 12 months later. So, it's just a matter of sort of putting things into context and into balance that, we have to sort out our house in terms of the government's cash flows. I hope there's nobody here from Treasury. But I think it's something that SMEs need to be aware of, that you can access procurement, but you have to have trade financing to back your working capital. You don't want to supply goods worth a million shillings and then you can't do anything else for 12 months. So that was just sort of like a side comment based on that new initiative. So I suppose going to the Trade and Investment Hub, obviously we are funded by the U.S. government. We are using, U.S. Taxpayer dollars. So our focus is on AGOA, which is the African Growth and Opportunities Act. And what that does is that it gives about 34 countries across Africa duty-free access into the U.S. market. And a few months ago in July, that was actually renewed for another 10 years. So what that does is that it gives companies here a tremendous opportunity to be able to produce and to actually export at almost no transaction cost. But there is a but. What we found at the Trade and Investment Hub is that whilst AGOA exists, what a lot of the SMEs say is that they don't actually have market intelligence on what the US buyers want. I think you've probably all been to the Maasai market around Nairobi, and you have all these beautiful accessories and belts and shoes and bags. Now, those are not necessarily the sort of designs that a US buyer will want. So in lots of cases, SMEs have to be, we work with them to actually alter their design We bring in international buyers to actually say, look, if you're going to sell to Walmart, this is what Walmart is looking for in terms of the level of quality. If you are going to sell this belt, you need to change your stitching just a wee bit to actually be able to access consumers in the US market. And we find that to be of tremendous use to SMEs, because at the end of the day, you can produce lots of good stuff, but if nobody wants it, you have a very big problem. So that's one thing. The other thing that we're working on is on the financing side. You know, we've all been talking about the issue around, you know, the requirement to finance. And what we've found is, even if an SME has a purchase order from a US buyer, we've actually had SMEs say, look, I have an order here for $100,000, but I need money to actually make the order. But I'm afraid to tell the buyer that I don't have the money. So what we're trying to do at the Trade and Investment Hub is build a what we're calling a trade financing platform, not with the banks, because unfortunately the banks see this sector, you know, the SME sector as being high risk. And the statistics show that SMEs generally do not get access to trade financing facilities. I think the statistic is 50% get rejected when they actually do a trade finance application, compared to just 7% rejection for multinational companies. So what we're doing, we're putting the big banks on the side, and we're working with some really innovative platforms in East Africa who are actually providing trade finance for very, very specific sectors. I'll name them. Umati Capital is one of them. They do trade financing for the agribusiness sector. Hiva Fund is another one that we're working with. They do a lot of trade financing for the fashion and sort of home decor and accessory sector. So, you know, our approach is a little bit more innovative. We're moving away from the typical big banking side of things. One of the things that we do is simply sensitizing the SMEs on the opportunities. Honorable Kanimba mentioned the information gap. We meet lots of SMEs who actually say, AGOA, does that mean I can actually export at a lower transaction cost than what I have actually at the moment? And we say yes. So a lot of our work is also just around sensitization and letting SMEs know what the opportunities are out there. And it's a regional focus, not just Kenya, all the five countries in East Africa.
Thank you. That's really phenomenal. And I think the access to information is something that it's sort of invaluable, right, if you're an SME, because that's not something you can easily access at scale. So moving over to you, Set, I know that you've done some work with the ITC where they've given you data and information to use sort of in the industry. Can you talk about how that's helped and how you've worked with the ITC?
Well, thank you very much. The arrangement with the ITC has been quite good. Already, we have had some experience in conducting surveys. Our business association has a special survey we call the Business Barometer Survey, which is done on a quarterly basis, and we are able to assess the mood of the business community about the business environment. But that is more on the policy side. We've also been conducting a survey for WEF, World Economic Forum. We do the Ghana version of the enterprises. But that's also focusing more on the international competitiveness of the whole country and the business sector as a whole. But at the firm level, we've not had this opportunity until the ICT came in. So we think that this is a very good opportunity to do firm level assessment, especially in relation to the ability to connect to the rest of the world. And the survey instrument is very good. We've looked at it, we've working on it, and it touches on a number of issues. One, what is the ownership structure of the business? If you are connecting to global world, if maybe you're going for partnerships or any kind of arrangement, they would like to know the nature of your business and the ownership structure that you have. Two, what is the capacity in terms of asset-based, in terms of your ability to deliver when you are giving orders? The assessment goes in quite extensively on that. Again, what is the efficiency level? Do you have the right people? Do you have the proper records that you are keeping, the management capacity, and so on and so forth? All these are being looked at. We are also assessing the quality standards of your product. And how do we assess quality standards? You probably are looking at the certification that they have, whether international or local. And indeed, some of the local companies have international certification. It gives the buyer or your connecting global partner the comfort that indeed you can deliver the quality that is expected. So you also look at the promotional aspects. To what extent are you promoting your product? Is it only local? Is it international? The extent of usage of ICT facilities is also very important. It tells you an idea, it gives you an idea of your level of competitiveness in terms of the international market development. And then also, we try to assess their knowledge about the business environment. Business environment indeed impacts so much on your capacity and your ability to deliver. So all this information has been very helpful. Now, what is also important is that with an assessment of this nature, we are able to develop the services that the enterprises need. And that, for me, is very important. As a business association, we are looking at financial services. We've spoken a lot about it. But the financial services, we are not only looking at access to finance. It's even ability to access finance. Are you able to prepare the necessary documentation? Do you have the internal capacity, the records, and everything that enables you to access a bank finance? Bank may be prepared to give you money, but if you're unable to access it because you don't have the capacity, it's a challenge for you as a business. So we are looking at that angle. There is also an aspect relating to international market development itself. And here, our association does quite a lot on that, and also trying to partner local and government agencies that are supporting the development of export markets. You need to develop all these services for the enterprises. And I think it's also very critical that it's giving us some information to focus on in relation to our business advocacy issues. As a business association, one thing that we do very well is drawing government's attention to various issues that affect the businesses and how to make them competitive. And the survey is throwing out a lot of issues that is enabling us to package our arrangement with government so that we know the areas that we should focus so that we will turn around the companies. I think what we realize in all this is that when it comes to SME development, you can't have a one-size-fits-all situation. Every enterprise has its own peculiar challenges, and you need to be able to identify that. If you come out with a program that says we are solving the entire problems, you cannot solve it. So you need to be able to focus, and you can only focus when you have done this kind of assessment. And the survey we are doing with ICT is really helping us to do this kind of categorization in terms of needs, in terms of capacity, in terms of financial area requirements, and so on and so forth. So it's been very helpful in all these. And I think that as we go forward in 2016, the survey, when we get all the results, it will be shared to all, and it's going to help a great deal. Thank you.
Thank you. And I think your point about focus is really important, because actually one of the things is that in a growing market and sort of with the concept of SMEs, there is such a tendency to sort of want to put out ideas on how you can help, and sort of actually executing on those is the key. And so I think using the data for that is very valuable. I think at this point it might be good to throw out sort of to the audience if there's a few questions, and I'll be happy to walk around with a mic if there are. Okay, we have one. Excellent. Perfect. So anyone, there's someone up here, and then there's someone at the back.
So. Okay, thank you. My name is Jane Muthiga from the Kenya Women Media Owners Association. I still want to go to the question of access, because many people, as Andrew puts it, are not able to access internet because of one thing of connectivity, number two, cost. But we have digital media, especially TV, which at least with now new media, the cost of TV is, is coming down. I don't know how much we are able to use the digital platform, the digital TVs, to be able to promote SMEs products, to promote information, and to to utilize the platform. Thank you.
It's a great question. Thanks for that. I think that this is probably not necessarily a focus of the Trade and Investment Hub, but I think what you're seeing in East Africa is more around agribusiness using television as a platform. So I don't know if people here are aware of Shamba Shape Up, which is a very well-known television program that has actually been sort of like associated with why we have so many city farmers. Because the television program teaches you how to grow chickens, how to put fertilizer in your garden, how to sell your product, how to not sell your product to brokers who are going to cheat you and give you poor prices. I think they were saying they have a viewership of almost 10 million since they started. And, you know, lots of private equity firms have been jumping on them to give them money. So, you know, I would say that's a fantastic point, and that is actually something that could engender, you know, the involvement in agriculture and making it sexy again for younger, you know, younger people. It's a great question.
Good afternoon. My name is Beatrice Mwasi from Center for Business Innovation Training. Last week, we had a forum that had been organized by Kenya Association of Manufacturers, and we were talking about SMEs. And this was a provision of financial services to SMEs by various banks. And it occurred to us that actually all the bankers that were present had a totally different definition of who an SME is. So I'm hoping that we have a common and coherent understanding of who an SME is, because we are all talking about SMEs without defining really about who exactly are we talking about. And we could be having totally different understanding as to what we are talking about as far as SMEs. Now, talking about competitiveness, we can't speak about competitiveness without really focusing on quality, quantities, issues of costs, and issues of timeliness to market. Now, looking at aspects of quality, really, and you've spoken well about it, we are so limited as SMEs as far as technology that allows us, therefore, to produce required qualities to compete locally and also competing internationally. The kind of infrastructure we have as SMEs does not allow that. Our appropriate technology systems have not helped so much so that we are able to establish systems to support that. Second aspect of quality, I've seen situations, I've worked closely with the Export Promotion Council, and I've seen situations whereby actually we go to international market platforms, we go to Ambiente, we come to the US, and we are promoting various items, but we come back home without any bankable opportunity because we cannot meet required quantities. Again, we are small, and we have not come together to take advantage of opportunities available, either internationally or within the regional market. So we actually fold back up. Of course, we have a lot of talks with regard to establishing clusters, and within clusters, we are able to augment what we have, become a little bigger, and be stronger to supply international regional value chains. But then, if we do not have a very strong, reliable, and sustainable connectivity with those international regional value chains, we have failed again to harness that, and therefore, we are limited as far as quantities that are required are concerned. So the question is, I'm just trying to explore, do we have a workable model whereby SMEs have money to come together, augmented their capability so that we can compete locally and internationally in a sustainable manner? So that's one thing that I would like to, okay, sure. to hear.
Thank you. I think your question is very, very, very important. And it puts actually a cornerstone for linking science, technology, innovation, entrepreneurship within our African continent. Last week in Egypt, as Comesa Business Council, and also I wear my other hat as the African Alliance for Women Empowerment and Scientific Research and Technology Congress, we had all the teams, the scientists, the academia, the entrepreneurs, the innovation, the youth, and the women. And a lot of the youth and the women, they projected their projects that they want to do, but they don't find how they finance it. Or they have the solutions for some addressing parts of agriculture, agribusiness, but they don't know how to link it with the rural areas and the small-scale farmers. So now there is a platform that we are creating about how to link the scientists and the academia, with the entrepreneurs, with the small-scale farmers on the ground, with the youth and women, to have the three pillars, actually, of supplying the science and technology. Like there is a certain, as the National Research Center of Egypt, we developed a solar dryer. And this solar dryer, now the small-scale farmers are using it for drying of their tomato and vegetables. They can dry up to 100 kilograms. So instead of spoiling their harvest and they don't know how to sell it, we help them as scientists to raise this into a dried fruits or dried vegetables that we help them also in packaging, branding, and access to market. They are now actually selling this dried tomato to Italy and France. So it's the whole issue is really how, as I mentioned, to have the holistic approach system of actually, I call them the 10 ins, which is the whole ecosystem. Indigenous capacity strengthening, how you strengthen the indigenous our new farmers in the rural area, the grassroots, the youth unemployed, all our people to have access to have an enterprise that we can finance and register it. Second in, which is I sell 10 ins, innovation, science and technology. How to have technology parks, how to have actually in the link it between the scientists in our African continent with the needs of the African continent with reference to agriculture, agribusiness, healthcare and drug industry, infrastructure and energy. It's all about how you empower them. The third in is increased productivity and the value chain. You see a lot of women growing, for instance, academia, and we're in Kenya here. I really want to remind you of the late Professor Wangari Maathai, because she was a very good friend of mine, and she always talked with me that the women in her constituency, they grow macadamia, but they cannot access the international market. There is a broker that comes and takes everything, and they are the one who profit. We need to empower our people on the ground to have actually value, to grow their role in the value chain. And this through business development centers and business incubators, how we incubate them, how to help them to have to grow in the value chain and increase their productivity and to connect them to the market. This actually, the four in is investment and access to credit. It's one item out of many. How can those youth who are unemployed, who have innovative ideas, they want to commercialize their innovative idea? How can we have actually investors to invest in their brains? It's about actually connectivity. It's about access to credit. It's about SME funds. It's about allocation of funds that the budget of the government should put to promote this into SMEs. It's about actually information, because a lot of our people on the ground, for instance, I personally went into, made a questionnaire for cross-border women traders between Zambia and Zimbabwe, between Ethiopia and Djibouti, between Egypt and Sudan. They don't know about COMESA. They don't know about those policy organs, what we are talking about, ICTs. They don't know. It's our responsibility to go to have outreach for those people, for those cross-border traders, to tell them this is how you do it, this is how you make it, this is how you develop your product, and you have access to the market. It's about information for all these trade agreements, for intelligence, business intelligence market, and that's what we supply in for the people. It's about industrialization. Last week, 20th of November, we celebrated the Africa Industrialization Day. It's about how we foster our industrialization in Africa using all the technology available. If we have HIVs, we don't have to bring our retroviral drugs from other countries. We have built the capacity of our industrialization. It's the whole issue about infrastructure. You know, how this is our, it's in infrastructure of everything. Infrastructure with reference to roads and railways, and that's why COMESA Business Council, last week here in Kenya, last 2 weeks ago, I inaugurated the infrastructure and the logistic and transporters meeting to get along together to say, you know, for production, if we have a good infrastructure, the cost of transport of goods will be lowered. Two months ago, in African Union, the PIDA, the Program Infrastructure Development in Africa, we need to have corridors that link all our roads together. So last 2 months, we had the last segment between Egypt and Sudan, the infrastructure, the road is done, the road. The cost of the products went dramatically. In Sudan, the orange was 25 pounds, Sudanese pounds. After this cost, it became 10 pounds. The square meter of the tiles and the ceramics was 250 Sudanese pounds. It went down to 100 pounds. So actually, infrastructure also works about our SMEs, because the cost of transport between one country to the other to have our regional integration agenda goes very high with reference to the cost of the product if we have good infrastructure. And then actually it's about our integration. If we have clusters, not everybody can do everything, but if we have centers of excellence, we have integration, we have intelligence information, what can we do and what can we excel in each part of our SMEs, in our, like for instance, Ethiopia, they have the Leather Institute for Leather. We have a lot of leather across all over Africa, but actually we are not doing it. We export it and then we re-import it. So it is up to us to see how we empower it. It's about the international market. No, it's about AGOA, but not only AGOA. It's about the whole international market. We have all the raw materials of the world. How we transform these raw materials into end product through value addition, through our connectivity together, and putting the whole institutional framework coming together. So I think it's these 10 is, I summarize always, I call them the SME development pillars. Thank you.
Thank you. Sorry, do you want to add something?
Well, let me just add something more concerning the issues to it. As far as quality is concerned, I think quality and technology are highly linked. The more advanced the technology, the better your quality. But it's not always the case also, because sometimes systems can make a big difference. You need to have structures that enable you to come out with a quality product. And even more importantly, when it comes to international business, it's about capacity to deliver. When you are given an order and you are asked to deliver by a certain time period, you should be able to do it. So you need to be able to assess your own capacity and take the volume of product that you can conveniently deliver. But then, another aspect of it, when it comes to AGOA, for example, the challenge we had in our country was that people get big orders, but their capacities are small. How do you link the various enterprises to it such that they can produce that big volume? So it means that you must have segregation of their responsibilities. You must have companies that are going out there and looking for the market. And then you must have those who are able to mobilize the enterprises together so that with the big of a big volume, each one of them will do certain parts, and then together you can deliver to the market. It is very important. We've been working a lot with the academia also to ensure that they help improve the quality of the products of our SMEs. What we noticed in Ghana some time back was that some of the research institutions were doing their own research that are not very commercially oriented, so they do it and it's in their shelves. Nobody's picking it to implement it. What we've done as an association and with government for the past few years is that we're trying to link the two quite closely so that when you're coming out with any research, it should be business-based, it should be commercially oriented research, so that you can actually solve the needs of enterprises. That is very important. We've had MOUs with a number of research institutions in Ghana. There's CSIR, that is Council for Scientific and Industrial Research, University of Ghana, University of Technology. It is very important. When it comes to quality, another aspect that is also critical, which I mentioned earlier, is certification. When you're doing international business and you want to be competitive international-wise, they're always looking at what kind of certificate do you have. What is the guarantee that if I give you an order, you'll be able to deliver and meet the quality standards that I want? Who certified this? The process of getting certification can be very challenging and traumatic for most small enterprises. So you need to have the institutions that are constantly giving that orientation, that these are the processes you have to go through if you want to get a certification. It should not be that expensive either. And you should have mechanisms to support them to have it. Even more importantly, when you have had it, it should not be one-off thing. You should consistently monitor the quality. Because if you deliver today, tomorrow a bigger order is coming, and you cannot fail the second order. So again, you need to monitor to be sure that your quality is consistent. That is very important. Business partnerships are very important. And I mentioned that if you have a mechanism of bringing the enterprises together, it helps a lot. But you need to have a proper legal framework that is well articulated to the enterprises. So they know that when you are coming, we are forming partnerships both at the local and international level. We know what the framework is, what our restrictions are, what we can do, what we cannot do, so that it helps us to prepare for business partnerships. Without proper legal framework, you can't have proper business partnerships. And then we've also talked about the enterprise level structures. You need to have firm structures, proper records, proper management systems, proper governance systems that enable you to partner with others to do bigger business. Thank you.
Thank you.